Blessed day. Welcome to the Underserved Favor Ministry online service. The ministry is here for you to experience God's love and grace in action, where the key to reign in life is revealed. We are so glad that you have joined us today to worship our heavenly Abba Father God and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So we want to thank you for welcoming us to your home or wherever you are right now. And we hope that you will feel God's presence and will have a meaningful experience in our worship, communion, tithes and offering, and the preaching of the Word. As your online family, we wish to connect with you and would love to hear from you. So please message us on Facebook at Undeserved Favor Ministry. We are also inviting you to send in your prayer requests and would love to hear your testimonies. For your prayer requests and testimonies, you can message us directly on Facebook at Undeserved Favor Ministry. You know, our eyewitness accounts are true-to-life testimonies of God's love and grace in action. And these accounts have greatly encouraged and uplifted many. And now we believe that God has a revelation in store for you today. Enjoy today's worship. God bless you. A blessed day and welcome to the Undeserved Favor Ministry online Sunday service. We're so glad to be joining you in your homes, in your establishments, or wherever you may be enjoying today's worship and word. I know you know that the enemy is using this crisis to divide us. The enemy is using this crisis, this COVID-19, to scatter us. But if you take a closer look, you will find that we are even more united. We are even more gathering online. We're even more together as one. And why is that? Because what God has put together, no man, no thing, nothing, not even this COVID-19 can put asunder. Because God has brought us together in Christ as one. Amen. Isn't that a good news? We know you're very excited to receive the good news today. So before we praise and worship, why don't we pray? Let us pray. Almighty and loving Father, thank you for bringing us to the homes and establishments of your beloved children. We're very excited to praise and worship you today. We pray that as we listen to the word, your grace and love will be revealed to us, because we need your warm hug and warm assurance. You said that as we are gathered, you are there. So we rest assured that as one body in Christ, today we will enjoy the praise and worship in your word for all the goodness that you are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Come on, church, let us praise and worship God for his greatness and glory.
Our God is great and glorious. Trust in your name, Jesus, able to save and deliver us. We put our hope in your name, Jesus. Yes, Jesus, you reign. You reign above all. There is no power here on earth that is above you. Not even this crisis, not even this COVID-19. It has no power over you. Only you have the power. Even your name has your potent power. Not only power, but your wonder, Jesus. Your beauty, Jesus, is in your name. What a powerful name. What a wonderful name. What a beautiful name. Jesus. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. Your sin was greater, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. You are raised to life. my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. And every knee shall bow to the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. The name above all names, Jesus. Yes, Jesus, you are the name above all names. You have the name above all names. The name even above this COVID-19. It's a name, but the name Jesus is above it. Our circumstances and our problems, they each have names, but your name, Jesus, is above it. Our illnesses, our diseases, they all have names, but your name is above it, Jesus. Your name above all names. You reign above all, and we rest assured, for as you are, so are we. As you reign, so do we. As you are beloved of the Abba Father, so are we beloved. And so you rest assured today, with an open heart, we will receive the revelation of your love. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen.
Hello, church. We have now come to our Holy Communion. So kindly make sure that you have your bread and cup with you as we remember the death of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so now, let us remember that before Jesus was betrayed, he gathered his disciples in an upper room. He took the bread, broke it, gave thanks, and gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body, which shall be broken for you. Do this as often in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for the forgiveness of all your sins. Do this as often in remembrance of me." And so, church, that bread that you're holding right now symbolizes the body of Jesus Christ. And every stroke, every stripe, and every lash that was placed on his body has brought healing on us today. And the cup symbolizes his blood, and every drop of his blood washed away all our sins, past, present, and future, so that today we stand righteous, favored, and holy before God the Father. So together, let's raise the bread and declare in faith, "Lord Jesus, you are my Savior. Your body was broken, crushed, and wounded for me. Today, I am healed, and I am whole. From the top of my head to the soles of my feet, I am completely healed. I receive this, Jesus. Thank you for loving me. Amen." Let me take the bread. Now raise the cup, and together we declare, "Lord Jesus, you are my Savior. Your blood was shed for the forgiveness of all my sins. Today, I am righteous, I am favored, and I am holy because of your blood. I receive this, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for loving me, and I love you too. Amen." Let me drink the cup. God bless you always, church.
We know that after the worship, you're even more excited to give your tithes and offering. But please be reminded that the giving of tithes and offering comes with a revelation that Jesus is truly alive in our lives. It is an act of faith and a privilege. So please do not feel obliged if you don't have that revelation yet. Be excited, because God will reveal it to you in His perfect time. For those who already have that revelation, and when you act out of faith, then there's nothing that will stop the floodgates of heaven to open as your Father in heaven has prepared everything for you. If you intend to electronically give your tithes and offering through online fund transfer, please indicate your name in the remarks field so that Pastor Renee can personally pray for you. With that, we invite you to raise your hand, your mobile gadget, and your tithe envelope for a prayer. Our most gracious and loving Father, you are indeed a good God. Your most generous ways never run out and never wear out. You give us seed for our bread and much more so that we can also be generous in every way, producing within us. Great praise to you, O God. We rest assured that you will reveal the message of tithing to those who are seeking you in it. Thank you for the privilege to tithe and offer today. Continue to honor and glorify yourself through our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Blessed Sunday, brothers and sisters. Thank you so much for joining us in today's wonderful worship. And I trust that you have experienced and felt God's presence as we had a worship, no? And of course, during the communion and the tithes. And thank you so much for joining us and welcoming us in your home or in your room or wherever you are. And I'm so glad that we have this wonderful time of gathering as one body of Jesus Christ. And we may not be physically together, but we are in spirit one because we are one body in Christ. And as we prepare ourselves to receive God's revelation from God's word today, let's be reminded of this very important truth, our identity in Christ. So together, join me in saying, in Christ, I am greatly blessed. I am highly favored. I am deeply loved. I am a winner. I am blessed to be a blessing. Again, in Christ, I am greatly blessed. I am highly favored. I am deeply loved. I am a winner. I am blessed to be a blessing. And why is that, brothers and sisters? It's because we are in Christ that we are blessed and even blessed to be a blessing. Amen? And that's the identity that we have. We are always being reminded in the Bible, when you read the Bible, you will see Jesus there, and you know that Jesus came, you know, to bring us this life and that is eternal. And that means that we are in Him and He is in us. And that's being in Christ. That's why we are experiencing and we are receiving all these favors from God. Amen. So one more time with conviction, we say, in Christ, I am greatly blessed. I am highly favored. I am deeply loved. I am a winner. I am blessed to be a blessing. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. You know, brothers and sisters, God wants you to really, really, really reign in life, especially during this time of crisis, during this season. And that's why we will continue to talk about our purpose in this season, because it's very important that we are empowered to really live our life, no, in this purpose. And we've started up to talk about that, and we will continue today. So as we start, let's start with a prayer. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for such a wonderful time to receive your word at this very moment. Father, open our minds and our hearts that we may be able to just receive the truth of your word and apply them in our life and live out the truth that you have spoken for us. And whatever you have spoken, it shall be done. And what you have promised, you shall fulfill. It shall never fail. And Father, allow us to receive your revelation today, and that we may come out in victory. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Thank you, Jesus, for that. So, as we continue with this discussion on our purpose, especially during this season, we are being reminded that who we really are, that's what's our purpose, really, you know, from the very beginning. And let me quickly review on that. In Genesis chapter 1, we have been told, you know, even from the very beginning of God's word, we are already told why we are here. Because This has been a compelling question that many people are asking all over the world. Who am I? Why am I here for? Where do I come from? No? And because people don't find the answer, the exact answer to this question of their purpose in life, the meaning of their life, they get lost along the way. They don't experience fulfillment. Because like, as I the last time I shared to you about purpose, you don't use the purpose, no? You don't use as an item, a cell phone for its purpose. You use a cell phone as a hammer. The cell phone will not be able to, in a way, be successful as a cell phone because it's not being used for its purpose, no? And so that's our life. We don't live according to our purpose. We don't have success. We don't feel fulfilled. Amen? And so let's quickly read, no? Again, Genesis chapter 1 in verses 27 and 28. And be reminded of our purpose, really, no? The original purpose that God created us. Let's read it in Genesis chapter 1, verse 27. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them. And God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. My friend, you see there, as you see on the screen, no, the verse 28, you will find God said, no? In verse 27, God created man in his own image. You see that there? Image, no? In other words, we're like God. We have the same image, the same spirit with God. And what is that? What's our purpose? It's to reflect God, no? To reflect God's glory. In other words, glorify God and have fellowship with Him. We be one with Him, no? That's what it says there in verse 27. No? Because we were created in His own image and likeness. So that's the first purpose, to glorify God and enjoy fellowship with Him. Now, in verse 28, it says there, as God blessed them, He said, be fruitful and multiply. Be fruitful and multiply, that refers to especially our relationship with one another. So God is saying, establish, develop that good relationship with others, with your fellow human beings. No? So that's purpose number two, that we may be one with others and have good or growing relationship with others as we grow in our relationship with God. So that's the second purpose. The third, it says there, and replenish the earth. Replenish. What does that say? You know, we somehow reproduce. We be creative, we work the ground, you know, whatever is available, and be productive. That also speaks of the gifts that God has given us, that we develop our gifts and we, you know, develop and use our gifts to create things, you know, to produce things that will bless others. You know, that, and in fact, use that those gifts, those talents, you know, to produce something that will benefit others, will bless them, and of course, in the process, build relationship and glorify God. So you will find, no, the purpose one, purpose two, purpose three are very related. And then it says here, and subdue what? Subdue the earth and have dominion over all creations of God. So this is to reign over, no? Not to be a servant or a slave of God's creation, but to be the master of God's creation. We reign over. So, you see, my friend, that's our purpose. And that's God's original purpose for man. And we need to understand that because exactly that's what we are here for, no? To live according to these four things, no? Glorify God and have fellowship with Him, and then grow relationship with others, and then work, use your talents and gifts to create and produce things and be productive, and of course, to reign over. the things around us. No? So, that, my friend, is your purpose here in this world. You might say, Pastor, so you mean if I use my talents, that's part of my purpose? Yes, very much. But you have to look at your purpose in the entirety, in a context. It's not like purpose number one, although I just enumerated it. But actually, it's a whole thing. It's a whole package. You don't just say, okay, I focus on purpose number two, which is relationship. No, you cannot do that, okay? You have to live as one, no? So you have to have, it's very important. You really want to live your purpose. That means have this relationship with God. No? Without this relationship with God, which I will talk about in a short while, without that relationship with God, you cannot live out the full purpose of your life. You cannot also live, na, you will just say, I will just spend my life with God and not with others. That cannot be also, because part of that whole package of your purpose is to spend time, grow relationship with others. No? You will say, okay, I have good relationship with others. I spend time with God. No, I meditate and I pray the word. And, you know, I do that. I spend time with God. But, you know, I will not use my talents. Anyway, I have not much. No, my friend. That's part of the whole package. No? And of course, number four, about dominion, about not being a slave by what? Material things. No, but be master over it. So this is the whole package, my friend. Huh? So understand this. You don't take it in compartments, no? As what God said here in Genesis chapter 1. You have to take it as a whole. It's a whole package of your purpose in life. And that's how you live a fulfilled, successful, happy, enjoyable life. Amen? So, that being said, we know what happened, no? So, let me just quickly bring you to a review of our previous message where sin spoiled the fun, okay? So sin somehow destroyed God's plan for man, no? For man's purpose. And we know that, no? I don't have to go into the details of that, but somehow man lost his purpose because of sin. How do I know that? Of course, it's obvious, no? When man sinned against God, he started to be afraid of God. And so when man is afraid of God, what's lost? Fellowship. Exactly, no? And because man is doing things against God's will, against God's commandment, and against God's design, what happens? Of course, man stopped giving glory to God, diba? And usually what happens when that's the case, man claims to be the one, not God. And you say, ako man gid adto, I was the one who made it happen, you know. It was because of my hard work. And so when you start saying that those words, or when you start thinking that way, you are not living your purpose, because your purpose is to reflect God's glory, no? So that's why I'm putting this on the side, no, but that's why it's very important that humility is practiced, no, within us. We practice humility. That in everything that we are able to do or produce or make happen, we always credit that to God. Because with the moment you claim credit and say, it was because of me, my own thinking, or whatever your ability is that you think yours and yours only, not given by God, then you stop glorifying God. No? And that's going to be a problem. Then you will stop living out your purpose. And eventually, you will live a dissatisfied and fulfilled life. So we don't want to take that path, you know? So especially now that we know that this is our purpose, then let's be very, very careful to live according to this direction, okay? As we have mentioned in the past lesson on this, or revelation, that, you know, our purpose is our destiny. And you don't go to your destiny. Actually, it's destiny that's pulling you. That's why when we get lost somehow we have this sense of this longing or this emptiness that, you know, longs to be guided back to our path towards our destiny. And what does the world call that? What's called, and I've seen a book of this title that says, Man's Search for Meaning. So that's exactly what happens when a person does not understand his purpose. No? Siya kasabot, para asa siya, unsay yung purpose, aning kalibutana, and does not understand the word of God, especially Genesis, that talks of his purpose, then he's lost. Now he is in pursuit of or in search of meaning. No. Man's search for meaning. And in Psalm 63, verse 1, it speaks there that there is this longing. No? We are longing for God's revelation of our purpose. Let's read that in Psalm 63, verse 1. It says here, O God, you are my God. With deepest longing, I will seek you. My soul, my life, my very self thirst for you. My flesh longs and sighs for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So, ang tao igsuon, no? Giuhaw. In fact, for people who do not have Christ in their life, grabe ang kauhaw. There's this emptiness, this longing, and they don't understand it because they don't realize that we, human beings, we were made or we were born with a God-shaped hole. Nataana, no? It's a God-shaped hole that, you know, there's this relentless yearning that only God can fill. Yes, when we were born, when we were created, nana siya. And so, because of that, if we seek, no, to fill this hole, this vacuum elsewhere, no, mangitatag. For some people, they look for someone, no, to fill that emptiness. But that person is still having also that emptiness, so pareha sila kulang. Pwede. Some people they seek to fill that emptiness, that hole, through material things, or probably through education, or through success in career, or whatever, no? Again, that's a God-shaped hole. Only God can fill that. So, that's a problem. That's why the truth is, my friend, and that's why we're talking here about this, your purpose. Because God wants you to live out your purpose because only God can fulfill you in this purpose. You see, the truth is people need the Lord. In Psalm chapter 16, verse 11, we will read. No? In Psalm 16, 11, it says here, You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. In your right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. So here, the psalmist is saying, Lord, I'm seeking for you because you show me the path of life. I need you to show me the path of life. I need you to show me the meaning of my life, the purpose of my life. Ninja, in your presence is fullness of joy. You know, when God is with you, you find your purpose and you will find joy and peace. In your right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. People seek pleasure of life through many other means, except God. And they don't find it because only God can fill that emptiness. In fact, let me show you a wonderful song. No, it's quite an old song, but it's a very beautiful song. It talks about people need the Lord. And you and I, brothers and sisters, we are Christians. We are in Christ. We need to understand that we have this calling. Because even before you received Jesus Christ and Lord as Lord and Savior, you had this emptiness. But the moment you received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, Jesus filled that emptiness. And for some of us, you might say, Pero Pastor, I don't still feel that emptiness being filled. Maybe because you don't know your purpose yet. And so hopefully, no, after this revelation that you will receive right now, that you will really understand, why am I here? Because you see, when you understand your purpose and you know and you understand how you live it out, you will experience true fulfillment and true joy and happiness. And so, come on, let's listen to this song. Now we will show you, and please read the lyrics so that you will understand really what it means. No, and it talks about people needing the Lord. Let's listen to it.
And now, Steve Green.
Every day they pass me by, I can see it in their eyes. Empty people filled with care, headed who knows where. On they go through private pain, living fear to fear. Laughter hides their silent cries. Only Jesus hears. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. At the end of broken dreams, He's the open.
You like that song, my friends? Well, it's a very beautiful song indeed, no? So it talks about people need the Lord. And especially during this time, people need the Lord. And many of them, they don't know it. They feel worried, they feel anxious, they're afraid. And they think it's because of the virus. It's because of the financial downturn that's happening because of this pandemic. Or it's because of this, you know, getting distance from others, that they feel isolated and that's why they feel depressed. No, my friend. You know, bisag unsaon pa nimo, bisan pag way COVID, bisan pag walay problema in your finances, bisan pa every day you have people around you, if you don't have the Lord Jesus Christ, you still have this emptiness that only God can fill. And that's why you just have to really need Jesus Christ, receive Him in your life. And that's what a lot of people in this world are missing, because they don't believe in Jesus Christ. Or if they have heard in Jesus Christ, but somehow they doubt that Jesus really loved them and that He really suffered and died for them. And so, what does that speak? Jesus' business in coming to earth, my friend, was to really resolve our issue with sin. That's the very purpose of coming here. To resolve that issue with sin. Why is that? So that we can live our life according to our purpose and live a meaningful life. Diba? So, that's why Jesus came. But Jesus' purpose to live His life is to live as Son of God. You know? And of course, to live a Son of God and build His kingdom with us as the brothers of Jesus Christ and God's sons and daughters, no? God's children. And of course, Jesus will uses His power to, of course, create this amazing eternal life with us and where we reign with Him. Diba? So, Jesus become now, that's exactly that's why the restoration plan was put into motion. No? And that's where John 3:16 came into reality. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish but have eternal life with Him. And so, look at it in that picture, my friend. Some of us may think, Pastor, you see, that's very good. I understand that. You know, Jesus loved me. He suffered and died for me. But you know, Pastor, that's religion. That's, you know, spirit things. No, my friend, this is not religion. Yes, this is spiritual, but this is not religion again. Let me emphasize that. And in fact, I don't care what your religion is. You can belong to any religion as you hear this, as you receive this revelation, but it doesn't really count. It doesn't really matter. Because what counts is your spirit being in Christ. This is very spiritual. And some say, "Pero, that's very spiritual, so it has nothing to do with my reality in this world." No, my friend. The truth is, everything started in the spirit, and this is spiritual because it has an impact on the physical. In fact, the Bible said, what is spiritual is eternal, it's lasting. What is physical, what you can see visible, is temporary. No? So, and I'm giving you this very important picture of Jesus restoring us to become God's children, and in that, restoring us to our purpose. No? The four parts or the four aspects of our purpose. Now, here's the thing, and let me now finally focus on this as I close. You know, brothers and sisters, my friends, this is our call. And what is that call? That we align our purpose with Jesus. Because we are in Him and He is in us. We are in Christ. Our life, this new creation life, new identity that we have it because of Christ. And so what does that mean? If you really want to be able to really live according to your purpose, because now, okay, we're given this new life, no, restored to that purpose, as was stated in Genesis chapter 1. But understand that you don't have this purpose, you don't have this life without Jesus Christ. It's not apart from Jesus. It is in Christ that we have this new life, this new identity, this being in Christ that we are blessed, favored, loved by God, no? In spite of our weaknesses, no? So, when you understand that it is because of Christ that we are restored to this purpose, then it's also important that we understand that we need to align how we live our life, align to God's or to Jesus' purpose. Diba? What is Jesus doing today? Ask yourself, what do you think is Jesus doing today? Now, of course, in the Bible, it says there that He is seated at the right hand of God. No? He is acting as mediator. Every time we say a prayer, there's Jesus at the right hand of God, no? Bringing our prayer to the Father. As if He is the one, no, making that prayer. In Anna, no? Because we are in Christ and He is in us. So that's what happens. But I hope you understand that, you know, Jesus continues to be the Yeshua. What's the meaning of Yeshua? That's the Hebrew of Jesus' name, Yeshua. What does that mean? The Lord saves. The Lord saves. You see that verb? Saves. What tense? Present tense. So, if I ask you today, what is Jesus doing? Of course, He's seated at the right hand of God, but what is He doing to the world? He continues today. He continues to what? Save the lost today. But how does that happen, my friend? If Jesus continues to save the lost today, how does that happen? Because there are so many still who have not received Jesus Christ. And, you know, for God so loved the world. Dili lang kita ang love sa Ginoo, ha? Everybody. That's why I'm so glad that, you know, there's this development I just learned about Israel and UAE, United Arab Emirates, signing a peace agreement. No? People having peace in the Middle East. That's very good news. Diba? Who does not want to have peace? So, why? Because God so loved the world. Even the Arabs, no? the non-Christians, God loves them also. Jesus suffered and died for them. So today, my friend, what is Jesus doing? Jesus continues to save the lost because there are still many of them. And so here's the thing. But talking of alignment, because we are part of the body of Jesus Christ. No? Like we could be the hand, we could be the stomach, we could be the heart, we could be the legs. What does that mean? As Jesus continues to minister and continues to save people who are lost. And this salvation, again, huh, is not about, you know, from poverty to... No. Well, that's the effect, no? From poverty to abundance. But what is he doing when he saves? He is what? Resolving the sin. He's resolving the sin. That's his purpose. That's how he saves us. Addressing the sin, no? And that's what he did already. He suffered and died for us. So the sin is settled. Every person now is being presented with that offer. Jesus is like saying, I have paid for you. Shall you accept my payment for you? No? For the sin. So, are you getting the hint, my friend, of how we align our purpose with Jesus' purpose? That we become instruments of his work of salvation to others. Did you get that, my friend? You and I, we live this four-part purpose to be an instrument of salvation for others. You spend time with God, no? Enjoy time with God and have peace with Him. That will lead to becoming an instrument for others to see Jesus in your life. And then, no? That building relationship with others, and then of course being creative, and then being master over, no? Things around you. All this, you live that you may become an instrument for others to also see Jesus and that they may be restored and that they may have also their purpose in life and live it out. Did you get that, my friend? Are you seeing a better picture now of your purpose, especially during this season? And see, when we do this and we start to say, and just okay, and I've seen some Christians when they were born again, they receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. They have this heart now. Sige, Lord, no, I will minister. I will evangelize. No, I will go to missions. Some of them, they go to that extent, no? To really, you know, go out and tell the good news. And I did that myself, no? In the office, no? I could not stop myself, but I was so fired up, no? When we have lunch break, no? While my office mates would, you know, eat lunch, I would not eat lunch yet. I would eat later. Because what will I do? I will go to them as they were eating lunch. They cannot leave, di ba? I talk to them about Jesus Christ. No? So that kind of fire, no? Because the moment you have Jesus Christ in your life, you start to feel, no? Wanting to be aligned to that as Jesus would go and continue to work his salvation for others. So, but you see, my friend, here's the pero, no? The but. Distractions come. Distract, no? You get distracted. By what? There are four things I have identified. Probably you can add for this, but I think the four distractions, can you know, others can fall into these four types. You could have distraction in terms of livelihood or your work, no? Or finances, no? Because, you know, you have to work, diba? So you have to make money and then things like that. You do business or you have to do your job. So somehow you get distracted in evangelizing, in spreading the gospel. Another is, it could be that you can get distracted by your relationships. You could be distracted because, you know, a loved one, or especially kung minyo na ka, no? Common na siya, no? I want to do this, but... I want to evangelize, but you know, your spouse would say, oh, don't leave me here, no? Things like that. So that could be as a distraction. No? I'm not saying it's bad, but it could be a distraction. Your relationship could be a distraction. And a third item or a third potential distraction could be your issues in probably health. Okay? So probably you have problems with your health, or you know, it could even be that you have a problem with how you speak. You cannot explain properly. You cannot say things properly. So with that, it can affect, you know, your desire to evangelize or to spread the gospel. And of course, for some people, they are afraid and they don't feel comfortable or not even happy about it. No, they don't feel joy. And so, or they feel like, I'm enjoying this more than spreading the gospel. So those four things that could be a distraction to a Christian in putting forward the gospel of Jesus Christ, the salvation. So with that, those distractions in our work or livelihood, probably in our relationships, or even in probably health issues or talent issues, diba? Or even happiness issues, or like you don't have peace. So that's why you're not able to spread the gospel. These are what we call in the world cares. No? These are the cares or worries of the world. And of course, when these cares and worries, they increase in you, of course, you get distracted. You cannot follow through, no? In telling people about the good news. Now, I have a good news for you, my friend. Because the truth is, these items that I said are actually distractions or cares and worries when they are not aligned to the purpose of Jesus. When they are not aligned. Because you see, these things are not bad, no? Livelihood or work, no? Finances, they're not bad. Relationships or even health, they're not bad, no? Or even your joy and happiness, they're not bad. But they become distractions when they are not aligned. What do I mean? Finances, livelihood, work. If you just focus on work, doing your best on your work, without looking at the big picture, that you're doing your work to glorify God, you're doing your work to build relationships, you're doing your work so that you can put in creativity, you're doing your work so that you will not be a slave to material things. Because some people, they work hard and they neglect spending time with God. They don't glorify God. In fact, when they earn so much, they say, it's my own effort. They don't glorify God. For some people, they work so hard to the point they lose relationships. No? Or even when they get successful, they rise to the corporate ladder, they get divorced. In the US, that's a common news, no? When they become very successful. For some people, they work so hard to the point that, you know, they've even lost peace because they're so afraid that their wealth will be lost along the way. So, what I mean here is very important, my friend, that we align these things to Jesus' purpose. In fact, okay, here's the good news, okay? This is what I'm saying, the good news. If you go back to Genesis chapter 1, the four part of this purpose package that God made us for, let's connect. When we say joy and happiness, isn't that when you are in Christ, when you are spending time with God, you are in fellowship with Him, diba? Jesus being the Prince of Peace. You have it. But in the context of God, no? You can enjoy peace, you can enjoy happiness. About relationships, you have concern with relationships. But isn't it number two of the purpose, which is that you grow relationship with others? Isn't that what God wants you to have? But again, you don't lose that path that you have this relationship so that you can grow that and grow your relationship with others. You don't have a relationship so that you will isolate yourself from others. When I was in college, I had a friend No, amigo kami, barkada kami, and you know, when uban miya na, and then with others, you know, we get along with other people also. But the moment nakauyab na akong amigo, di na mo uban sa ako. And then we not even go with other classmates. Kasi sila na lang uban-uban siya ang uyab and have isolated themselves. No? So, what's wrong with that? No, I mean, it's good that he has a relationship, but what's wrong is when they started to isolate themselves with other from others. And so, see? And what about issues on concerns on finances? Diba? That's the third part of the purpose where you use creativity, you work, and you know, from the work that you make, diba, you get blessed. And then, of course, like for example, mga health issues. Diba? Diba have dominion over? Even in our body. No, we take dominion over our body. In fact, by Jesus' wounds, we are healed. So, God has given us that dominion over our body and the things around us. So, you see, my friend, actually, distractions, which actually, when I was a new Christian, I would hear this from other Christians. And they would say, ah, those are distractions. Ah, work is a distraction. That's why, you know, you cannot go to mission and evangelize because work is a distraction or relationship or health issue. But then you know what I realized? They're not distractions when you are conscious to align them. When you are conscious that you are making, no, or leaving these things out to glorify God, to build relationships with others, to use creativity to be productive, and of course, to be master over everything in our surroundings, in our environment, what God created. So, actually that, my friend, is living out your purpose with all these things. So, these are not, what I mentioned, are not distractions. In fact, let me tell you this. Let's turn your distractions to directions. Okay, let me say that again. Let's turn your distractions to directions. Meaning, let that lead you to your purpose. Because exactly, they point to the purpose in your life. No? The four things that I've mentioned. So, let me close with this question. So, how do I really align my purpose with Jesus? How do I? And what are the benefits if I align my purpose, no, with Jesus? So how do you align? Let's simplify it based on God's word. Live your life bringing Jesus to the people. Because the people need Him and He loves them. Make that as your purpose. Make your life be focused or geared towards glorifying God, bringing Jesus to the people. And you will be amazed that you will be even well provided. You will be well provided. And let me remind you in Matthew 28, the Great Commission, in verses 19 and 20. It says here, go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. So here, no, Jesus is commissioning, instructing us, first from the disciples and then kita karon, to really go. This is very important. In fact, this is very important. You know it's very important because Jesus is about to leave the earth. He is about to ascend to the heavens. And you know, like any person, diba, kung ay tao, diba, kung mulakaw, may ngong ginang, oi, wana, ang kwa na, panugun ba, katungkan ba, ikalimot ha, katungkan. Very important, no? Before you leave, you mention those very highlight, no? Very important things that you want people to remember. And this one here, when Jesus was about to be lifted up to heaven, this is what He said in Matthew 28. Go, therefore, make disciples of all nations. See? So, that's the heart of God. To tell the world of His love for them. That to tell the world that Jesus already suffered and died and has already settled the sins of the world. And that's what Jesus is telling us. So, when He tells us that, He's saying, you're part of me, you're part of my body. Now that I'm in heaven, you move. You're my body. You be the one. You be the instrument to tell the world of this good news. Also in John chapter 15, no? In verse 16, what does it say there? John 15, 16, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you would go and bear fruit, and that your fruit would remain, so that whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he may give to you." So here, God appointed you, no, Jesus appointed you, that you would be fruitful. And he tells you something. He says, ask whatever, and it will be given to you. That's a promise, that's a guarantee that you will be successful in your appointment, in your success, in your mission. Because he will provide you with everything. So you will find here, my friend, if you align yourself with Jesus, your purpose with Jesus, no? And that means, no, bringing the gospel, because Jesus loves them, God loves them, bring the gospel, you align that, whatever you do, no? Whether you're an employee, you're a businessman, you're a housewife, you're a child, you're a student, or, you know, I don't know what you're doing, but align that to Jesus' purpose, you will be amazed, because you will even be well provided. You can even ask whatever, no? And that's a blank check. Whatever you can believe, Jesus is saying, whatever you can believe, ask. And it shall be given to you, because God wants to make sure that you are well provided for to succeed in your mission, no? To go bear fruit. Isn't that amazing, my friend? So, very important thought that I will close with is, how you live out your purpose is the measure of your true success and fulfillment in life. Let me say that again. How you live out your purpose is the measure of your true success and fulfillment in life. In analogy, quick analogy lang, because I'm closing this. If I tell you, paint, no, this, the backside, no, my backside, paint it with green. No, I tell you that, I give you that instruction. And then immediately, you painted this side here with a very lively color red. It's an amazingly colored red. Nope. You painted it, but it's red. So what does it say? Well, you could be a very excellent, you're very good in painting. No? You made red very alive, but you are very wrong also. Because that's not your purpose. Your purpose, your assignment is paint this back side with green. So, and that's what some people are doing. They're doing something very, very good, but very, very wrong. But because it's not according to their purpose. And that's why no wonder, my friend, no matter how successful you are in painting this side with red, and you're very excellent about it, but you will not feel fulfilled. You will not have the true success. And you will not enjoy the peace and the abundance that comes really from God alone. Because you're very wrong. You're not doing according to your purpose, what you have been called for. So, as a quick mention of gifts, it's the same thing with your gifts. No? We use our gifts and it can lead us to more wealth. No? It can bring great wealth to us. And many people, they accumulate great wealth only for themselves, for their own benefit. No wonder they're still empty. Because remember that God-shaped hole, no amount of money can fill that, only God. And so, it's the same thing with our wealth today. Our wealth, the purpose of our wealth is to advance God's kingdom. So in the same manner, your gifts, your talents, use that to advance God's kingdom. And as promised in John 15 verse 16 we have read, you will be greatly provided for. Like, you know, I like people who are a blessing to me. And I want to bless them also in return. And I'm sure some of you like the same. Diba? That's building relationship. That's the second part of the purpose. When you are a blessing to others. So, God is pleased with that. And yet, in the process of being a blessing to others, you get blessed even more. So, my friend, your purpose in this time or in this season is to really be the body of Christ, an instrument of Jesus' work of salvation to others. I'll give you quickly an example of people, no, who have really succeeded and lived a fulfilled life, even today, aligned to Jesus' purpose. One is Billy Graham, if you remember him, if you know him, no? A great evangelist. He's a minister. So in the area of ministry, Billy Graham aligned himself, no, only glorifying Jesus Christ, making sure that his life reflects the glory of God. No? He spends time with God, fellowship, building relationship with others, and using his talents and his skills, no, to be productive and bless others, and of course have dominion over. He lived up to, I think, 99 years old. And very successful as a minister, as a pastor. Another person I could give as an example is Stephen Curry. No, he always, you know, every time he makes a good shot, you know, points up to the heavens, like recognizing, Lord, this is because of you. And he is today, as I've lately searched, the highest paid NBA player in 2020. I can also recall Gary Vee, of course, you know him, diba? His songs were Christian songs, but somehow even, you know, patronized in the secular world. I remember once in Manila, in a parang kanabitong ferris, kanang, what's this, carnival, no? Gary Vee performed a concert. And what did he, what were the songs he sang? Shout for joy, sing his praises, you know, all these Christian songs. And everybody was singing and dancing. And I don't know if they're Christians or not, but they were singing to the Lord through his songs. See? So he was using his talent, singing in the entertainment world, glorifying Jesus, bringing the name of Jesus Christ to the world. There's one more example I can share with you as I close. In the business area naman. Kasi Stephen Curry, sports, Gary Vee, entertainment. It's a business area. No. Yeshua. Okay? So, I don't have to go far. Yeshua. Because sa Yeshua, no? Every time we discuss with any client, as in like any client, we tell them first what Yeshua means. The Hebrew name of Jesus Christ. And we tell them we believe in Jesus Christ and we believe that we are here to be a blessing to you. Tell, no, regardless of who they are, no, the clients. And one way or another, we're doing business, we talk about solutions and things like that, but somehow they know and they hear Jesus Christ because we bring the name of Jesus Christ. And of course, along the way, when we provide a service, we do our best, no, that we are able to really provide an excellent service or solution. And in a way, somehow, no, some people, you know, initially when they send us an email, you know, respectfully yours, and then we respond with, thank you and God bless, and then run, and things like that. Some of them, the following email that they, when they reply, they would say, thanks and God bless also, no? And then when we talk over the phone or over Zoom, when we have a meeting, and say, God bless, God bless, ay, God bless. What's that? But, you know, we're infecting, no? We're telling them about the good news. We're telling them about Jesus Christ. And slowly but surely, even in the business world. And by God's grace, God has been raising Yeshua, no? Increasing its scope and its reach. No? Today, by God's grace, Yeshua is already reaching to the whole Philippines without much effort because God has tapped into Yeshua partners. And I'm just telling you, but that's what's happening with Yeshua. So what I'm saying is, God is glorified. He will make sure you're well provided. and sa Yeshua in the business area, we are experiencing that. So, my friend, what's in God's heart? And I'm closing with this question. What is in God's heart? In God's heart are the people of this world. In God's heart, He is longing to bring back the people He created for fellowship with Him, and that these people may reign over His creation. In God's heart is that He wants everybody back to Him, reconciled back to Him. That's why Jesus came, suffered, and died for them. In God's heart, you are the apple of His eyes. He wants you blessed, favored, and loved. He wants you to be a winner and a blessing to many people. In God's heart, He wants to use you for your brothers and sisters that God loves also. Because He wants them also, like you, blessed, favored, and loved. My friend, that's your purpose, especially during this season. God wants you to be the body of Christ, to be the instrument of the work of salvation that Jesus is doing even today. You be the hand, you be the heart, you be the mouth, you be the legs, you be the whatever, but you will be the instrument of Jesus' work of salvation today. You align your life, everything you do, in that purpose, guaranteed, my friend, you will experience fullness, success, true fulfillment in life, and you will be well provided for. That's guaranteed in the Word of God in the Bible. Whatever you're doing, whatever may be your occupation or your role in life, you may be a father or a mother or a child, an employee or a homemaker, no? Or a student, whatever. Live that purpose. Bring the name of Jesus Christ to people. Start with the people around you, probably in your family, or the person near to you right now, or probably the one in your list, in your Facebook account. Start with that. My friend, I promise you this. And in fact, the reason I'm here speaking to you right now is a testimony. Because the moment I started to really align my life to Jesus' purpose, I've experienced amazing things that I cannot even tell you everything today. But that's why I continue to stand before you right now. No one is forcing me, okay? No one is pressuring me to deliver this message. No one. But there is this peace and joy that I'm experiencing as I receive revelation and I said, pass it on to you. Because it's my own experience also. The goodness of God in my life. And that's why I cannot stop myself. Tell you, tell everybody I can reach to, that Jesus loves you, Jesus loves them, and He wants to use me to be an instrument of salvation to you and to everybody else, and God also wants to use you as an instrument of salvation to everybody around you. My friend, people need the Lord. They really need the Lord. And you are the representation of Jesus to them. Be that person. Align your life, your purpose, and you will be amazed how great God will perform in your life. Is that good news, my friend? Praise God. That's an amazing news. And that has, in fact, propelled me into this, even to this ministry in UFM, because of the goodness of God in my life. And so, I encourage you. Come on, live out your purpose because God loves you so much and He wants you to live a successful, fulfilling life. Amen? Praise God. I trust, my friend, that you are receiving this revelation today. And as we close, I would like to invite you this very important prayer of faith in Jesus Christ, because this is everything how we started. Okay, so pray with me in this important prayer. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, you are my Savior. You suffered and died for me. Your wounds are for my healing. Your blood washed away all my sins. You died, but now alive in victory. Now I can live your life of victory. Thank you, Jesus, for loving me. Amen. You know, my friend, if you pray that prayer, I know you have received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And this time, you are in Christ. Christ is in you. Start living out your purpose by aligning yourself to the purpose of Jesus Christ. And how do you do that? Bring Jesus to the people around you. Bring Jesus to the world, and you will be amazed. You will be well provided for, and amazing things God will perform in your life. Amen? Thank you, Jesus, for that. Okay, so before our closing prayer, my friend, one more declaration of who we are in Christ. Come on, because we are the grace generation. Let's continue declaring and say, I am in Christ. I am righteous because of Christ's sacrifice. I am greatly blessed, highly favored, and deeply loved. And why is that? Because Jesus loves me. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, close your eyes for a prayer. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this time of worship and revelation. Father, I pray that everybody who has heard your word today and have felt your presence be so blessed that everything that they have received will be so ingrained and imprinted in their hearts and in their minds that they will be able to understand fully, you know, your revelation and live them out so that they can enjoy life and live a successful, fulfilling life. Father, that's all you want for all of us, to have fellowship with you and that we may enjoy life to the full. So I pray, Father, for all my brothers and sisters and friends right now, that you help us all to live this full and abundant life. This life living our purpose aligned with Jesus' purpose. And that you may be glorified also through us. Father, thank you for this wonderful time of revelation and gathering with your children. And may you continue to bring us wisdom, provision for all our needs and wants, even protection from any harm, healing for any sick body or any part of our body. And of course, Father, peace and joy to every heart. All glory and honor to you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Brothers and sisters, enjoy your week. Stay safe, stay home. I'll see you next Sunday online. God bless you always.